Alright, my initial goal for this project was to build my ultimate ESP32 shield. A shield for all my frequent sensors from RGB, relays, you name it. And technically, I did. Here. But stick around, I'll share with you what I did, what didn't quite go to plan, and what's next. Let me kick things off by explaining why I started this project. It's pretty simple, really. To minimize the mess. Shields are fantastic for streamlining prototyping and small projects, allowing me to spend less time fiddling with wires and more time bringing my projects to life. Going back through my past projects, I noticed a pattern. I kept reaching for the same set of sensors. So I decided to consolidate them all into one shield, essentially creating a Swiss Army knife for sensors. And voila, this was the result. A shield with all my commonly used components. I managed to cram in an array of sensors, an AHT20 temperature and humidity sensor, an analog light sensor, 4 RGB LEDs with individually addressable LEDs, 2 general purpose buttons, a centrally placed PR or motion sensor, 2 Hall effect sensors, a mini relay, a buzzer for alert, EEPROM for saving settings and small data, an optional SD card reader on the back, as a last minute addition, headers for a human presence sensor, the popular LD2410 with its tiny headers. Now, most of these sensors are pretty familiar, so I won't dive too deep into their specifics. However, I do want to highlight the relay. It's not your usual mechanical relay. Unlike those popular blue ones, this relay is designed for low power voltage and current. I opt for it for a couple of reasons. First, I prefer to steer clear of main voltage, reserving this for commercially available UL certified devices. Here, I have focused on controlling low voltage devices like the garage door opener, thermostats, HVAC system controls, and doorbells, most of which operate in the 24 volt range. Secondly, its compact size was a major plus. Traditionally, relays can be quite bulky, potentially dominating half of the shield real estate. This smaller relay offered a variable trade-off in terms of size and functionalities. Plus, it boasts built-in voltage insulation, ensuring a safe operation from the relatively higher voltage from both the shield and the ESP32. With the design finalized and the shield manufactured, the finished product was in my hand. I was eager to put it into the test. One of the initial applications I envisioned was a multi-sensor room gadget. So I set about writing the code for each sensor, laying the groundwork, so to speak, for easy reusable code snippets down the line. It was during this phase that I stumbled upon the ESP Home. If you're familiar with ESP Home, you'll know how effortlessly it is to integrate the IOI sensors like this into Home Assistant. After adding all the sensors in ESP Home config file, I had all the shield sensors and components at my disposal within minutes. It was almost too easy. At this point, I could confirm that all the sensors were wired correctly and capable of providing readings as well as controlling the LEDs, buzzers, and relay. That was a relief. What's more, I could now log all of these readings and maintain a history within my home automation system. This is going to be handy later. The process was so seamless that I ended up creating 3 of these gadgets, leaving them plugged in into Home Assistant to gather data. However, as is often the case, the honeymoon phase didn't last long. The first hiccup when I noticed the temperature sensors were producing, let's just say, questionable readings. Despite being indoor with temperature ranging the 19 to 21 degrees Celsius, the sensors were reporting temperature ranging from high 20 to low 30s, and this discrepancy persisted across all 3 gadgets. Initially, I suspected a software issue, so I played with the ESP Home settings in a bid to fix the problem. I added the EHT20 flag, still no luck. played with the I2C speed, still no luck. I even allowed the sensors to run for a couple of days, hoping they will settle into more accurate readings, but while there was some improvement, the offset remained significant. However, after looking at the plotted temperature readings over some days, it occurred to me that the readings had strong correlation with the actual temperature. It was a simple offset. I assumed the PCB itself observed the heat from the ESP32, the voltage regulator, or maybe the LEDs. While this was assuring in confirming the sensor's usability, it underscores the need for calibration, which I was hoping to avoid. As of now, I wouldn't rely on these temperature readings for precise applications, but they serve as good supplementary sensors in my projects. And now today's video sponsor, PCBWay. I've been a loyal user of PCBWay for several years, using their services for my DIY project and 3D prints. I'm a big fan of their $5 for 10 pieces promotion, allowing me to experiment without breaking the bank. If you share my passion for DIY project and looking to elevate your creations, consider giving PCBWay a try. You can find a link to their services down below. Now back to the video. The second issue emerged with the RGB LEDs. When I boot those gadgets, the first LED would turn green and freeze, a glitch that needed some multiple restarts to resolve. It was a bit strange. Oddly, this issue only happened with ESP Home. After some trial and error and rearranged the code, moving the LED section to the top. Surprisingly, this seems to do the trick. But I'm not sure if the sequence of the YAML entries matter. If you are familiar with ESP Home and have insight to share, please do share in the comments below. With that issue behind me, I turn my attention to this sensor. After soldering the human detector sensor in place, I faced a roadblock. I couldn't program the ESP anymore. I have to admit, it was a mistake on my part. That's what happens when you rush it and you add a sensor in the last minute, as I mentioned before. I should have known better. It turned out I used the same serial port that is used for uploading code, rendering the serial port unusable whenever the sensor is connected. Thankfully, the solution was straightforward. I simply have to unplug the shield before I flash the ESP. Well, at least the good news now is I have verified that the serial connection is functioning properly and the triggers are being detected. However, I didn't have the chance to play with this sensor a lot. I'll put it to the test later on. Which brings me to the final chapter. What comes next? Currently, I am focused on refining the shield to address the issues I faced. Firstly, I plan to relocate the temperature sensor outside the shield area, far removed from the heat generated areas by the ESP or the other components. I am hoping placing it something along those lines far up here should solve the heat creep problem. Moreover, I will work on removing any copper sections surrounding the sensor. If you have any good ideas or recommendations, feel free to share them in the comment below. Secondly, I'll be moving the MMWave to use the second serial port on the ESP to resolve the conflict I had before. Another solution is to remove the serial connection altogether, since it can be done over an app using Bluetooth, or perhaps abandon this sensor altogether. What do you think? Is it worth the hype? Should I keep it in, or should I drop it for the next version? Well, that's a wrap. I'll continue refining the shield and share updates along the way. Once it's polished, I'll make it available in my store. But before I sign off, a huge thank you to my YouTube members and Patreons. Your support goes straight into making projects like this. So thank you. As a small token, I have extra shields to spare. If you are a member and want to get your hands on one, I'll send you one free of charge. Just cover the shipping. Check the description below for more details. And once again, thank you for watching.